The Vatican's top sex abuse investigator tells his fellow clergy members daily conversion is a must for a bishop.
The people rightly expect you to be men of God, to be holy, to live simply, to pursue personal conversion daily. For them, in the words of St. Augustine, you are a bishop. With them, you are called to be a follower of Christ.
Archbishop Charles Scicluna, speaking during day one of the summit yesterday, he was quoting Pope Benedict XVI's letter to the bishops of Ireland from 2010. Archbishop Eamon Martin, the Archbishop of Armagh, Ireland, is taking part in the summit. Your Excellency, thank you for joining us. Expectations are high, and the world is watching this summit very closely. What's the mood inside, and what are the bishops saying to each other?
Well, thank you for speaking with me. We've just finished the second day of this very important meeting, and it finished with prayer and with a very moving testimony by an abuse survivor from Italy. And it really reminded me that it's the voices of the victims, of the survivors of abuse, which are echoing through all of the conversations, the discussions, the input here at this meeting. Pope Francis is here, of course. Today's the feast of the chair of St. Peter. And we really feel that we are the universal church gathered here with Peter, realizing this awful wound on the body of Christ, which we now have to heal.
And if today's theme is accountability, the question for many faithful Catholics and the public at large is, how will bishops who abused or cover up abuse be held accountable?
I think it's very important that everyone is accountable for these heinous crimes, which have so destroyed and betrayed the trust that so many good people have placed in the church. Accountability ought to be at all levels. And that was stressed today because the theme of accountability was situated within a discussion of synodality and collegiality. It's a shared accountability. We all must ensure that we're doing everything possible to prevent abuse happening within the church. And then, of course, if we do not follow our own guidelines, then we have to face that and accept that if I, as a bishop, for example, or as a priest, does something awful like this or fails to act, then how can I continue to act as a leader, as a shepherd within the church? Or, for example, as a bishop, how can I be a principle of unity within my diocese and indeed within the church? I think there's an acceptance here in the hall today that we are accountable first and foremost to our own conscience. We're accountable to God. We're accountable to the people of God. We're accountable, of course, to the criminal and civil law. And most of all, we're accountable to those poor people who have been so sorely damaged by their experience of abuse within the church.
Archbishop Martin, as I mentioned, you're from Ireland. The crisis in the Irish church has been devastating. Have you talked to your brother bishops about your own experience in dealing with sex abuse?
The experience of the church in Ireland has been a bitter one. I don't like saying that we somehow know a lot about this issue, because, of course, anything we've learned about this issue has come through the bitter experience of our dear faithful. However, it is true that in Ireland we have developed many processes. We have entrusted our accountability to our lay faithful, experts who are competent in the fields, these professional fields of safeguarding children. And we have found that we have indeed developed a national board for safeguarding children who ensure that we have the very best standards of practice in safeguarding, who also hold us to account. Our national board audits each diocese and each congregation to ensure that we are actually doing the things that we say we will do. And therefore, that accountability at local, diocesan, regional, and national level is very important. I think that somehow people might think that if the Pope clicks his fingers, then suddenly everyone in the church will do what they have to do. We know, of course, the principle of subsidiarity also exists. The best place to protect children is on the ground, in the daily activities of the church, in every single place that they are within their parishes and within their dioceses. And for that, We need the help of our lay faithful. And in Ireland, we have benefited with the wonderful contribution of hundreds, thousands even, of lay faithful who are helping to ensure that children are as safe as possible within all church activities.
You mentioned how some people hope or wish Pope Francis could snap his fingers. As you know, there are some victims of sex abuse who have come to Rome, say they're disappointed with the meeting so far, obviously with very high expectation. What's your message to them?
I can understand that. I think that we must always, as I said at the beginning, we must always keep the victims at the core and at the center of all of our deliberations. I feel within the hall that there is indeed an openness to full accountability on this issue. And I certainly have been urging my brother bishops, and I will continue to do this, to ensure that we leave this meeting with at least a complete commitment to concrete actions which will show that we mean what we say when we say that we want to eliminate, minimize completely any risk to children within our church.
Well, many are calling this such an important meeting for the history of the church. Archbishop Eamon Martin, Archbishop of Armagh, Ireland, thank you so much for telling us about it and telling us what's going on with the meetings inside.
Thank you very much, and God bless you and all your listeners and viewers.